In this lesson, we're going to talk about water reclamation and reuse. What we mean by that is taking wastewater, treating it to a very high level, and then putting it back into the environment for reuse. And we'll talk about different categories of reuse. Now, this might sound like an interesting concept. Why would we ever want to take wastewater and reuse it? Doesn't sound like a very pleasing idea. But in fact, we find out that we've been doing this throughout all time. You see, we take water out of a river, we use it, and then we put it back into the river, and that water flows downstream, and then another community takes it out, uses it, and puts it back in the river. And so we find that this has been happening throughout history. We say that the city of New Orleans, which is blessed to be at the bottom of the Mississippi River, by the time the water makes it down to New Orleans, that water has been withdrawn, used, reused multiple times. And we call this de facto reuse. Nobody necessarily recognizes or stops to think and realizes that that's what's happening, but in fact, that was what is happening. And so this is an example for us that we're not talking about a new concept. We're actually just talking about what's been happening throughout history already. Another example of this would be what we call night soil. What is night soil? Well, this term goes back to the 1800s. And for example, in the city of London, people would go to the bathroom and that waste would go down into the basement into a tank or a cesspool. And then at night, of course, this was done at night because nobody wanted to see this sewage coming out of the basement. So at night, there would be people that would go in and empty those cesspools and they would take that waste out into the farms, and they would put that on the farmland as a fertilizer. And so it became known as night soil. Actually, a very effective fertilizer. In some ways, more effective than the synthetic fertilizers we buy today, because in addition to the nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, this waste has lots of other elements that we also need in our diet. So this is an example of reclaiming the nutrients that are in our wastewater for agricultural activities. And so we have water reuse, wastewater reuse, and we see in 1890, Mexico City began to build canals to take the wastewater from the city out to the fields to fertilize the fields with this resource, thinking of it not as a waste, but as a resource. A little closer to home, here in the United States, in 1906, we see the first example in Oxnard, California, where guidelines were set up for using this wastewater to irrigate agricultural fields. And so we actually had guidelines or regulations on how to do that. In 1926, we see that the Grand Canyon National Park instituted a dual plumbing system where the treated wastewater was used in a dual pipes for flushing toilets, for irrigating the lawns and the area, and also for boiler water. And so again, we see water reclamation and reuse as early as the early 1900s in the United States. In 1932 in San Francisco, they began using reclaimed water to irrigate the lawns and the ornamental lakes in the Golden Gate Park. In 1968, we see the first instance of what we call direct water reuse. And what this means in Windhoek, Namibia, and this is a result of a major drought that occurred in Namibia in southern Africa, they took the wastewater, treated it to a very high level, and they put it in the distribution lines along with their drinking water. And we call this direct water reuse because the water was treated and directly put in back with other waters to be the drinking water for Windhoek, Namibia. And that was in 1968. So we see many examples over time, over history, of the progression of this idea. It's not a new idea. It's an idea that's been around for all time, and it's an idea that's been growing in interest and application in more recent times. Well, now we've looked at multiple states and other countries. Let's go to another location. Let's go to outer space. And you might say, well, what does water have to do with outer space? Well, it turns out when you look at space missions, as these missions go into space, they're not able to take all the water into space that are needed for those missions. And so it turns out they have to reclaim and reuse water. The earliest way this was done was by perspiration, sweat. The sweat was captured and reused, and over time they had to move to urine, recovering, retreating, and reusing that liquid. And we see then that this is important in a space mission because of the precious nature of the water, but also the precious nature of limited weight going into space. So we see that this reminds me of that old adage, necessity is the mother of invention. When there's a necessity for something, we start thinking about more creative ways of reusing things. So why do we consider water reclamation and reuse? Well, there are a number of reasons. Now, the first is this is a very effective way to manage our limited resources, our limited water resources. And so just in terms of how we use that water. The second reason is because of energy. I talked before about this city of Norman takes its wastewater and puts it in the South Canadian River, and then that flows downstream. And then the city was thinking about bringing water from 30 miles away as one option for a future water supply. Well, why are we letting water flow downstream by gravity and then having to pump water from far away when we could just take that water that's nearby, treat it, and reuse it and save all that energy of bringing water from further away? So it's very effective in terms of our limited resource of water and energy. One important consideration is, what about the water quality? Is the water quality sufficient for the intended use? And it turns out with our modern technologies for treating water, wastewater, that the quality is more than sufficient for the need that we have for the water, whether that's an industrial use, irrigating a lawn or a golf course, or even when it comes to thinking about human consumption. And so the water quality is also favors the concept of water reclamation and reuse. We also find that this concept of water reclamation and reuse enables us, encourages us to capture the valuable resource that's in that wastewater. I talked earlier about night soil and how that was taken from London in the 1800s and put out in the fields because of the fertilizing capability. Well, in this water reclamation reuse, we can capture and reuse some of these nutrients that are in the wastewater. And so we're taking this waste and turning it into a resource. Well, it turns out an interesting benefit of water reclamation and reuse is the sustainable nature of the water supply. It turns out the communities use water. We drink water, or we take baths. We use water whether we're in a drought or not. And so the amount of wastewater that's generated does not decline significantly during a drought. And so that wastewater becomes a continual source of water supply even in the midst of a drought, where the lakes may be decreasing because they're not being replenished by rain. The discharge from the wastewater treatment plant does not decrease in the same way. So actually, we maintain the security, the viability, the continual nature of our water supply if we're looking at our treated wastewater to supplement our water supply source. Well, how can we use this reclaimed and reuse water? What are some of the applications? We've already talked about several of these. That can be irrigating lawns or irrigating a golf course. Actually, the University of Oklahoma golf course is irrigated with reclaimed water from the Norman wastewater treatment plant. We can use it in industries as a supply of water, a cooling water for cooling towers in an industry. And so these are just some examples of how we can use this water. Another example of water reuse would be dual plumbing, where we have two sets of pipes in our home, one for drinking water and one for reclaimed water that we use for flushing toilets or other such purposes, irrigating our lawns. And so in this case, water reuse could be used in the parallel pipes. The water that was used for flushing toilets we would call non-potable water, non-drinking water, whereas the water that goes to our kitchen faucets we call potable water or drinking water. And so we can have different types of water reuse. So in potable reuse, drinking water reuse, we can think of several ways to implement that, direct and indirect. Indirect simply means that we treat the wastewater at a high level and then we put it into a river or lake, or we inject it into the ground, and at some other location we withdraw that water. And so what we have is an environmental buffer. We have a difference between where the water enters the environment and where it comes out. And so there's a disconnect, or there's an environmental buffer. And we call that indirect water reuse. Direct water reuse would be where we treat the water at the wastewater treatment plant, and from there the water goes directly into the distribution system and goes to the homes. And so that's a direct water reuse. Now there's a certain yuck factor associated with, that's a highly technical term, yuck factor, associated with the idea of taking wastewater and putting it into our drinking water supply system. And we call that sometimes affectionately is known as toilet to tap. And so the indirect water reuse has the benefit of that environmental buffer that separates that out, and it helps to minimize the yuck factor. But we do see examples. In Windhoek, Namibia, as early as the 1960s, and in Singapore more recently, we see examples of direct water reuse. Logically, you would probably see indirect water reuse implemented first, and then over time, people may become more comfortable with that concept, and then you may move towards direct water reuse. Well, what does water reuse look like in Oklahoma? And we've actually had some recent regulations that have been established to promote water reuse. I have to say that in the 2.5 decades that I've been at the University of Oklahoma, I've seen an increasing interest in and an increasing openness to the concept of water reuse. And as populations tend to grow, the amount of water we have on Earth is not going to change. As there are more people on Earth, the amount of water stays the same, and so the need for, the potential for water reuse will only continue to grow. And so it's helpful to understand these concepts, to have discussions about these concepts. It's not just a technical issue. The technology, as an engineer, I'm familiar with the technology. The technology is pretty much there, is there. It's more of a cultural, social, political aspects of the concept of water reuse. Where water is very short, in California, in Florida, we've seen the population migrate to water reuse sooner. And so California and Florida are leaders in the United States in the concepts of water reuse. Oklahoma is right there in that transition state and moving more and more towards the concepts of water reuse. And over time, you'll see that even the wetter states, the states that have more natural rainfall, as their water supplies become insufficient, there'll be increased interest in the concepts of water reuse.